This week's Hot Topics, Pandemic Report 2022. What's the latest in vaccinations and mandatory quarantine? We asked Jakarta Hotels Chief Sjefke Jansen. Health Haven, Bali's building an international class hospital, but will medical tourists come? And Lucky Strike, a man hit directly by lightning lives. How you can stay safe in a storm. Hello, this is Hot Indonesia. I'm Dalton Tanonaka in Jakarta. My co-hosts, Sandrino Malakiano, Deputy CEO of Polmark Indonesia from her home in South Tangerang, and Millie Lukito, CEO of the Mobiliari Group on the road lakeside in beautiful Vancouver, Canada. Hot topic number one, Pandemic Report 2022. The start of the new year brings new hope, particularly in finally ending the global coronavirus pandemic that's killed nearly 5.5 million people and crippled economies. Some positive news: booster shots will become available next week for 21 million eligible residents in Indonesia. In all, more than 280 million vaccination doses have been given. Daily case numbers continue to stay low. And for you, Millie, in particular, mandatory quarantine for returning residents has again been changed down to 10 days from 14 for non-red zone origins. Time to feel even more optimistic, right, Mill?
Yes, indeed. And actually, I heard that by mid-January, if the Omicron cases are still very manageable, quarantine time might be reduced to even 5 days or 3 days. So I'm waiting here for even more good news. And I so look forward to hear more updates from our hotel general manager on the new quarantine policies.
Okay, we'll get to him shortly. And you know, this is in kind of deep contrast to the rest of the world. I mean, Omicron cases are jumping in Europe, the United States. Of course, it's not as severe as we know. We have yet to see a jump in the number of cases overall here in Indonesia after the holiday season, which some feared. Sandrina, all the warnings, restrictions, and precautions seem to have worked.
Yeah, Dalton, I really, really hope that there will not be a surge of new cases in the beginning of this new year as the holiday season has just ended. And we could all see that a lot of places were packed with people who wanted to enjoy the year's end holidays. It appears that we are not seeing any significant increase in the number of new cases. Hopefully, it will remain this way.
Businesses are, I believe, beginning to breathe a bit easier, even those that depend on international tourists. Sjefke Jansen is chairman of the Jakarta Hotels Association, also general manager of the iconic five-star hotel Indonesia Kempinski. Sir, thank you for joining us. Just first question, generally business-wise, what are occupancy levels generally in the capital?
Well, occupancy levels generally still very, very good. I mean, we have picked up a lot over the past 12, 14, 16 months. So we are seeing an increase in occupancy. Having said that, we are very, very grateful because most of the occupancy is contributed by the community, or let's say by the domestic market. And for that, you know, staycations have become increasingly popular, especially over the weekend with the adjacent mall to the hotel. So all of that has shown a very positive trend.
Okay, now let's get to one point that is a sore spot among some people. There is a perception, sir, that hotels are making big profits because of quarantine business. Now, is that a misperception?
Yeah, I think that we can clear right away. That is a statement I would not support, not for any of our members, not in our association. I think for many other hotels in the city as well. The rates for quarantine business are much lower than you would get naturally from international travelers. As I mentioned before, we have great support from the domestic market, but it's just not enough to top up with the missing international market. And that's also why many hotels are taking quarantine business. But the rates of quarantine business are certainly lower, and not only the rates, but also the dynamics, the work flow is completely different from a normal hotel guest. In quarantine business, we serve three meals a day. We serve an afternoon tea. That means every room has to be attended four times a day. That is extremely labor intensive and certainly needs much, much, much more work than a guest that would just stay in the hotel, not in quarantine.
Yeah, you'd certainly prefer regular rates than quarantine rates, even though it's giving you some business that you wouldn't have. Okay, Millie, question for Sjefke, please.
Yeah, Sjefke, why do the government they make a vague statement about whether it is 7 days or 10 days. Do you know why this is in particular why?
I think there is probably a little disconnect, that is my assumption, between the institutions who make the decision whether or not to reduce quarantine business and the ones who are communicating the quarantine business. Probably there's a sort of disconnect where it's not the first time that happened in the past as well. So we have to really be patient also as hoteliers, but even more so as guests, because there are a lot of numbers floating around, 14, 10, 7, 5 days. We currently stick to what we have, and that is 10 days for quarantine business. That's what is the last official announcement. So until further notice, we have to just proceed as it is.
But Sjefke, you're saying disconnect. What does that mean?
I mean, disconnect is probably the flow of information doesn't flow through entirely, not at the desired speed it should be flowing through. So there is somewhere a halt that maybe should be looked at, because as I said, I mean, we all heard over the past 48 hours of reductions of quarantine stay period, 14 to 10, 9 to 7, but officially announced, we have not received any information on that yet.
Okay, and this is midweek, we are taping this program. Sanjina, question for Sjefke.
In the beginning of September last year, together with my family, I underwent a 7 days quarantine period as soon as we arrived back in Jakarta from Columbus, Ohio. Just to share our experience during quarantine, everything was okay, except for the fact that we had no access to fresh air and the sun. The hotel, it was a very good hotel, but it had no balcony access and the windows could not be open as we were in a high-rise building. But we could not get out of the room at all, no access to designated open air spaces. This was quite inhumane. What kind of special monitoring or evaluation systems does the Jakarta Hotel Association implement to improve such situations, to solve such problems based on the complaints forwarded by people who are still in or have undergone quarantine?
Yeah, thank you. I believe you are one of many, many, many guests who are facing similar problems. We have two rooms with balconies in our hotel, which are constantly sold out. I think that would be most likely a structural issue that probably cannot be overcome anytime soon. The majority of rooms do not have balcony, neither are they able, guests are able to open their windows. I believe that will be something probably to look at the future when you construct newly. But in most cases, I know, and we are all aware, that quarantine, already tough as it is, becomes even tougher because you have really no access to anything other than TV, the minibar, and probably a computer, and that you have to live with for the majority of the week.
Not going for quarantine bubble systems?
Quarantine bubble systems as to?
As to like a certain area of the hotel that is confined only for people
yes,
under
yes.
quarantine.
Yes, we have, all hotels have that as well. I mean, we have assigned areas, designated entrance areas for quarantine business. You can't go through the main lobby, for example.
No, but Sanjina, you mean whether they can go out and get some fresh air, right?
Yes.
A leisure area. No, I don't think any hotel has that, right?
No, you can't.
Not yet. We're not heading that way yet.
Okay. No, you can't. You are not allowed to leave your room. Our staff is actually not even not even allowed to meet you as a guest in the hotel. We placing all the foods in front of the room. Then we notify you by phone to please collect your food from the door, outside the door, and place it outside the door after you're finished. No, there is no designated area for guests, for quarantine guests who can enjoy being outdoors. That doesn't exist in any of the hotels.
And I think Sandrina and Millie, we have to endure this. It's an emergency situation. Just think of it this way. Places like Hong Kong, they have to do 21 days in tinier hotel rooms with no windows or no balconies. So we everything's relative. Sjefke Jansen, chairman of the Jakarta Hotels Association, thank you very much for that information and your time, sir. Okay, Hot Indo will continue shortly with Health Haven. If we build it, will the medical tourists come?
Ingin mengumumkan kerjasama dengan The Indonesia Channel. Saya mendorong semua entitas untuk bergabung dalam upaya ini dengan mempromosikan produk dan layanan mereka di platform digital yang unik ini.
I love Indonesia. I love the food. Yummy.
Ingredients. Now I'm ready to cook. Let's go to the kitchen.
It's done. Let's meet to eat.
Foodipedia on the Indonesia Channel.
Halo guys, nama saya Gali. Saya hobi touring. Untuk menambah fitur keselamatan dan keamanan di jalan, SDP adalah jawabannya.
Fitur yang paling saya sukai adalah pembatalan sein otomatis. Jadi ketika kita menikung, setelah tikungan itu selesai, seinnya akan mati otomatis.
SDP, great!
I'm Chen Mingan, a visitor and net Viet in Hanoi.
I'm Thairat Thongya of Thailand's Thairat TV in Bangkok.
I'm Monica Somborat from the National Television of Cambodia in Phnom Penh.
I'm Raymond Goh of Malaysia's TV Tiga in Kuala Lumpur.
I'm Glenda Chong of Singapore's Channel News Asia.
I'm Sachin Tommy of the Indonesia Channel at the ASEAN Secretariat in Jakarta.
This is your weekly look into the dynamic Southeast Asia region.
ASEAN Today on the Indonesia Channel.
The Best of Bali takes viewers on a special guided tour to the treasures of the Island of the Gods.
Well, the romantic dinner is beautiful.
The Best of Bali, only on the Indonesia Channel.
You are watching Hot Indonesia with Sandrina, Millie, and me. Here's hot topic number two, Health Haven. Bali is one of the world's premier tourist destinations for its beaches and culture. Now, the government wants another kind of visitor, the medical tourist. So on December 27th, ground was broken for the Bali International Hospital in Denpasar, planned to be a world-class facility in partnership with the respected Mayo Clinic in the U.S. President Joko Widodo pointed out at the groundbreaking that Indonesia loses nearly $7 billion a year to overseas providers, with 2 million Indonesians going out of the country for treatment. Sandrina, makes perfect sense to do this.
Before I respond to your statement, Dalton, I would like to inform you that the location of this new international hospital project is very close to my house in Sanur. I could just walk for a few minutes to get there, taking the same route I always use when we take our children for a walk to the beach. Okay, right. Nevertheless, establishing this Bali International Hospital with the aim to make it a magnet to attract medical tourism, every aspect must be based on thorough and valid research. So all the needs of future hospital clients, patients, their families could be met, especially if Indonesia wants to attract those who, up until this moment, still prefer to go abroad for medical checkups and treatments. From my own personal experience, my family has made NUH, the National University Hospital in Singapore, as our trusted medical facility to get good medical treatments and consultations. Because there are several basic aspects that need to be covered when someone is in need of medical diagnosis and treatments. First of all, we need best doctors, specialists, highly experienced experts with proof of success. A doctor's credibility is of utmost importance. In this context, the quality and results of medical services plays a very important role and sets a certain benchmark. I have heard many stories of Indonesians who choose to go abroad, for example, to Singapore or Malaysia, because they have been misdiagnosed by doctors here in Indonesia. So they expect a higher standard of expertise and quality of service.
Okay, so you're saying basically, Sandra, you know, you don't trust the medical services here, which is true in some cases, yeah. I think. I mean, every country is not perfect, but and the reason why, for those watching again overseas, why Indonesians go away for medical procedures because of the perception of low quality of service. Now, Millie, it makes sense that identifying and recruiting talented doctors has to be the priority.
Of course, you are looking for the best health doctors, nurses, and all the health practitioners, but I think one of the most important aspect in choosing where to go when you are diagnosed with something is your insurance policy, whether you have an insurance policy that covers this particular hospital or this particular doctors. If your insurance policy covers this Bali International collaboration with Mayo Clinic, then that patient will then go. But I don't think any patients would want to go to a specific doctors or hospitals or other health practitioners without first consulting with their health insurance policy, I do think.
Yeah.
So it is commendable for our government to do this, and it's about time. But I think there are still so many homeworks to be done, and so many other things that should be managed well before this Bali International Hospital can be something that is for this hospital to be successful.
Well, yeah, it's like anything. It's your content. It's your product that has to sell it. You know, it's beautiful in Bali. I mean, we're talking about two different groups, right? The domestic people, they don't want them to go abroad. And that you know, insurance and whatever, and then you're talking about the overseas people coming here, combining a Bali vacation, right, with medical treatment.
I think the foreigners or people outside of Indonesia, before they decide to go to this facility, again they will consult if they are indeed covered by their insurance policy. Otherwise, I don't think they will go to this specific hospital. What? Unless they are vacationing in Bali, something happens to them, it's an urgent matters, then they go.
I have a different
perspective, because what Millie is talking or focusing about is like medical treatment if you're already ill. But if you go for medical checkup, then it could be an option, because usually insurance, they do not cover medical checkups.
Also part of this facility, the announced plans, will be a nursing school and a research center when it's scheduled to open sometime 2023, next year. Quick, ladies, Sandrina, what is your assessment for success?
Well, it's really good, because I've actually seen the project design, and it's really, really cool. Even they have a resort there, and it's like totally renovated, because it's a compound owned by the government, in which already currently there is an existing hotel. So they're gonna renovate everything and make like a facility for nurses, as you said, and they have like specified clinics and hospitals for cancer and for other types of illnesses. So what I see, that this is going to be a big thing.
And real quickly, Millie, you know, again, the president says he wants to keep the locals at home, locals like yourself. Will you stay at home after this facility is built?
Yeah, I will probably try. Of course, I will try. But I'm a bit skeptical because, you know, we need that high quality doctors and physicians, nurses. And those are the things that are actually very challenging now in Indonesia. So I believe this Mayo Clinic, Mayo and Bali Hospital, will need such a longer term actually to be successful and to be able to do what it's supposed to do.
Sure, let's hope for the best, think positive. Okay, ladies, more Hot Indo is ahead. Lucky strike. This man lived to tell his story of being hit hard by lightning.
Welcome to Yoga Bliss. Exhale, reaching down to triangle pose. Roll your knee out and up to the sky, breathing here.
Yoga Bliss, only on the Indonesia Channel.
And you are watching iPop Playlist.
Kau datang di hidupku.
Terus berlari.
We play Indonesia's best music video.
Kau goreskan warna baru.
You are watching Hot Indonesia from Jakarta. Hot topic number 3, lucky strike. A rainy day in North Jakarta during Christmas week. A security guard walks with an umbrella when CCTV video shows a lightning bolt making a direct hit. Authorities believe it was the walkie-talkie in his hand that drew the lightning. The man survived and is recovering. Man, that's scary, scary video, ladies. You know, an estimated 24,000 people around the world are killed by lightning strikes every year. Here in Indonesia, we are particularly prone, scientists say, because of our geography and also because lack of building safety. I want to expand on that. Millie, that means when you hear the warning siren on the golf course, don't linger, get to a shelter, right?
Of course, I immediately run away, you know, from the rains. First of all, I don't like the rains. And I know somehow in Indonesia, there are so many lightning thunders, you know, and I saw the video of that guy and I feel so bad, and I'm happy that he's alive. But yeah, Dalton, this goes for you too. You know, when you play golf, you better run away
from the I've been guilty of that. Just saying, no, let's play. Come on, it's okay. It's just a light rain. But it's not the rain. It's the lightning. I get it. Okay. Now, in 2017, the latest case I found, two people were killed by lightning here as they sat in a tin-roofed shack in Aceh. So the issue, Sandrina, is tied to raising standards and economic progress, actually.
Yes, amongst others. And also, like, plain knowledge. I mean, if it's raining and there's thunder, you do not, like, bring something with a metal top or contains metal. It becomes a lightning rod. If I'm not mistaken, that guy was holding an umbrella, right?
Yeah, you saw the video. He had an umbrella, but also had a walkie-talkie. Yeah. That's what they believed, right?
Yeah, but there is, you know, Dalton, there is, I mean, you should know, then avoid being outside, especially with an umbrella when there are lightnings. But there's an interesting data here. In the beginning of 2002, a professor from Bandung Institute of Technology, or ITB, his name is Professor Reynaldo Zoro, he made a research and found that the deadliest lightnings in the world actually exist in Indonesia. To be more precise, in the city of Depok, West Java. This even became acknowledged in the Guinness Book of World Records. So this topic of the danger of lightnings is closely related, as you said, to the characteristic of Indonesia's terrains, which are naturally prone to lightnings. That is why we must ensure that not only buildings and public facilities, even houses are properly equipped with lightning rods. My house, the first thing I do as soon as the roof is set is like put on lightning rods. We must also be cautious when dealing with nature's forces. And the government must also issue regulations that would force people to take the proper actions when nature strikes, so we can avoid casualties.
Sure, and I mean, when I mention economic progress, you know, the poor do not have the resources to build proper facilities, so they sit in these tin shacks that draw lightning, and that's, you know, that's unfortunate, and that's where the government can step in. Okay, it is feedback time, one of our favorite segments. Sultan posted this on the YouTube page of our partner TV1. Omicron cases are on the rise. I hope the government comes up with an effective plan. And Aidan had this to say, happy to have seen my Christian brothers and sisters celebrate Christmas. That is the beauty of tolerance. Here's how to contact us with your feedback. Email at hotindo@theindonesiachannel.com or post something on our Hot Indonesia, Indonesia Channel, or TV1, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube pages. Final words, Sandrina.
We have passed the first few days of the new year. For me, the most correct way to define the importance of time is to remind ourselves that we are now around 350 more days away from the next new year, 2023. This means we should not waste any time, use the time we have the best we possibly can, must move fast, work fast, not allow ourselves to be overpowered by laziness. Time flies so, so fast. So let's make 2022 a year where we could multiply good deeds, do the best we can in helping others, help protect and preserve our nature and environment. Make 2022 a much better year than all the years that we have passed. Let us pray and believe that 2022 will be a magnificent year.
Final words, Millie.
Well, here's my New Year's resolution. I will never, ever sing I'm Dreaming of a White Christmas anymore because in Vancouver, we are now experiencing daily snowstorm. And in fact, my song has changed to I'm Dreaming of the Indonesian and Balinese sunshine. So never again will I say I miss the White Christmas. But now I can tell you, all the audience, that I miss Indonesia. And I appreciate being in Indonesia. And I think that's the best country to live for my entire life.
And my final words, some corporate news that's close to home. The Indonesia Channel is joining Music Hub Indonesia, a new digital platform that works with artists and businesses. We believe that working together will create even more compelling content. Now, TIC won't be going anywhere except up. And the three of us will still be here, right, ladies? For Sandrina Malachiano and Millie Lucchito, I'm Dalton Tomonaka. Thank you very much for watching, and please join us again next time.